James chapter 3. You'll notice in that first verse, Paul calls himself a prisoner. He does the same thing again, chapter 4, verse 1. That's what the message is about this morning, about being a prisoner. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Ephesians 3, verse 1. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles. It's a wonderful thing to be a prisoner of the Lord. I'm a prisoner, you might say, in a way. I'm bound to my wife, am I not? I wear this ring. This ring means I'm bound to Miss Eva. It means I'm property of Miss Eva. Right?
Yeah.
Basically, that's what it means. Yeah. It means you can't marry me because I'm already married. I'm already taken. Sorry. I have to talk to Miss Eva because... Right? We are bound to Christ. We are His. We are not our own. The Bible says you've been bought with a price, and oh, what a price. What a price was paid for your soul. The precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was shed for us. That sinless, priceless blood. And so, we're His. We're bound to Him. You see, Paul also refers to himself in other places as being servant. Servant of the Lord. Here he calls himself a prisoner. But his cords of love, chains of peace, it's like a good marriage. It's a good kind of bondage. Now some people look at marriage as, oh, that's a terrible thing. Oh, you're going to be bound with that same person all your life? Oh, dear, you know? Well, if it's the wrong person for you, or you married the wrong person, yes, it can be a terrible ordeal, I'm sure. But if you marry the right one, if you marry the one that God wants you to marry, it can be a wonderful thing. And this relationship we have with Christ is a wonderful bondage. Is it bondage? Yes. But it's a good bondage, like a good marriage. Okay? The Lord refers to us as being His bride. Church, the saints of God. And one day we'll be together forever. What a wonderful picture. One day He's coming back for us. He's going to take us home. And we'll have the marriage supper of the Lamb. We'll have a celebration. Maybe there'll be some chocolate. What would the chocolate in heaven taste like? If the chocolate here is good, what's it going to taste like there? I wonder. You think I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. Oh, it's going to be wonderful. Being with our Lord forever. Paul here says, prisoner Jesus Christ. Well, we do understand that this epistle written to the church of Ephesus was one of the prison epistles and was written by Paul while he was in prison in Rome. Remember, he appealed to Caesar, and they said, okay, since you're a Roman citizen. And it was God's will that he stand before kings. Remember, God said he would stand before kings and the Gentiles, right, and take the gospel. So he did stand before Caesar. I'm sure he gave his testimony. It was a man that God used to stand before some great people in his day and share the gospel. This was written, yes, from prison. So was Philippians, and Colossians, and Philemon. But I want you to notice how Paul phrases this verse. He did not say the prisoner of Rome. He did not say prisoner for Christ. He could have said that. But no, he says, I'm the prisoner of Jesus Christ. What a good attitude he had about being in prison.
Yes, he was there in prison.
Or he was in a place where He was confined and released. He had some liberties. He was able to write letters and so forth. And I think people could visit him and that. But he was confined to a place kind of like a prison. Maybe it was a house or something, but he was under guard by Roman soldiers. But oh, what a good attitude he had. He looked beyond the Roman soldiers and Rome and all the legal, you know, trouble he was in or whatever, the accusations against him, and said, no, I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Yes, amen, what victory, what glory, what a good attitude. That we'd be like the Apostle Paul, have a good attitude before God. Look at verse number 2. If you have heard the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. Notice verse 5. Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles, that's us, remember the pagans, the heathens, should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel. Now this is a chart by a gentleman named Clarence Larkin. And I may not agree with everything Clarence Larkin's works, but he did do some good drawings. This is one of them. He calls this one the Mountain Peaks of Prophecy. So way back in the Old Testament, long before the Apostle Paul wrote the book of Ephesians, we had revealed truth that God gave, okay, to the prophets of old. And as they would look and they would have their visions and God would reveal things in the future to them, and certainly he did, we have those recorded for us in the books of the prophets, the major prophets and the minor prophets in the Old Testament. Things such as the birth of Jesus, how he would come, where he would come. Very interesting. Micah and other books tell about that. Calvary, how our Savior would be crucified. David gets into that even in the Psalms. Isaiah talks about it. These are things that they saw. Also, Pentecost talks about that as well. And in the book of Joel. But you notice here we have a valley. And this we would call the church age, the age in which we're now living, or the grace period. In between when Christ first came and his second, so his first coming and his second coming, or first advent and second advent. And this was a kind of a mysterious area that they could not see very clearly. Well, this is where we are now living, between the two comings of Christ. We're actually, as we saw maybe a couple weeks ago, we're at the very end of this valley, okay? Right before he comes back. These things were not revealed, this valley in the Old Testament, this church age valley or the grace period. They looked beyond that, and then they saw the Antichrist. We read of that in Daniel. We read of the second coming of Christ, Christ setting up his kingdom, the millennial reign of Christ, and the new earth as well. So not everything was revealed to them in the Old Testament. Just, you might say, certain peaks that God allowed them to see. So this is what Paul's referring to. Well, which in other ages, verse 5, was not made known to the sons of men, as is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. So Paul is revealing things that now relate to us, now living in the church age, now living in this period. Mysterious, yes. A part of the mystery of Christ. How that Christ would, I guess if you had spoke to some of the Jews in the Old Testament, told them that one day the Gentiles would be a part of the body of Christ, and God would bring them and make them fellow heirs with the commonwealth of Israel, they would have been, what?
Yeah.
You know? But it is true. God did do that. And God's had mercy on us. You see, the Israelites, the Jews, they were God's chosen people from Abraham. Right? The father of Israel. Very special people. God revealed himself through this nation in a great and mighty way. And even some of the greatest kings, some of the greatest empires had to admit that those people, the Jews, the Israelites, they serve the true and living God. Now, we got our gods and we got our goddesses, but they got the real thing. You know? We see King Nebuchadnezzar. Remember the fiery furnace deal? Oh, your God is, he's the Most High. You know, he's the real thing, right? And he, in his day, was one of the greatest kings in the world. So God greatly used the Jews and the Israelites. And it's sad to see the shape of them today, is it not? How they've turned away from God's plan, Christ. But we have been grafted in. What a blessing. Verse 8, Paul says, "Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints." Now listen, Paul had a lot that he could boast in. Remember, he was a Pharisee. These guys were highly educated in the Word of God. They were esteemed among the Jewish people. Some of the most religious, most devout Jews that there were. He was a brilliant man. Could have had a lot of prestige, no doubt, with his credentials, right? His background. I believe from the, what was it, tribe of Benjamin, I think. But no, he says, I am less than the least of all saints. What humility, eh? We need to stop boasting ourselves. Stop lifting ourselves up. You come into someone's household, hey, take the lowest seat in the house. Don't try to be noticed. Don't want to be noticed. Put others before you. That's Christ-like. What was Paul being? He was being a true Christian. You can be saved and not a Christian. Did you know that?
That's right.
Be saved and not act like a Christian. Paul was acting in a Christ-like manner. Very humble. Not a fake humility, but real. Lowering himself. I'm sure Paul felt guilty about how he had treated the Christians before he got saved. Remember, he used to hunt them down, persecute them, put them in jail. He was there at the stoning of Stephen. He had part in that, the first martyr of the church. I'm not sure what his reasons are exactly for saying this, but I know that he was a humble man, very humble. And we should take notice and be likewise. Is this grace, he said, given? This grace is given to me that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. Grace. What grace, amen, has been given unto us. He said that I should preach by this grace the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make all men see, not some, not just a few, but all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world hath been hidden God who created all things by Jesus Christ. Christ is the creator. It's been said that grace is God's riches, Christ's expense. What you enjoy today, your salvation, the love of God in your heart, the security that you have in the Lord, knowing you're saved, knowing for sure you'll be with him forever and have eternal life, is all because of Christ. I spoke to a lady this week at her door. Miss Abby was with me. She said, I don't pray to Christ. I don't believe in Christ. She said, I believe in God, but I don't believe in Christ. I don't think you need Christ. I said, ma'am, this is the way God made. It's his way of salvation. It's through Christ. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. He is the only way. How can you turn down Christ? He proved he was God. He raised himself from the dead. Everything hinges on the resurrection, does it not? Without the resurrection, we have no hope beyond the grave. None. None whatsoever. Thank God for Christ. Oh! Unsearchable riches. Unsearchable means inscrutable. Cannot be understood by human reason. That's how great are the riches of Christ that's been bestowed upon you. They're so great, so awesome, that you can't even understand them. Certainly not with the mind that you have right here and now. Maybe one day we'll know more. God will reveal more to us in our glorified state, our glorified body. But for now, oh my goodness. We cannot ever wrap our minds around how good God has been to us. Don't you feel it? Don't you know how good God's been to you? How privileged you are to be saved? Do you realize how few people in the world are that are saved, truly saved, and know it? A lot of religious people, a lot of moral people, people go to church, but they don't know they're saved. Christ gives assurance. We talked about last week how that we're in Christ. You can't get no more assurance than that. We've been bought the price. We're his property, the prisoners of Jesus Christ. Look verse 10. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church, that's us, the saints of God, the manifold wisdom of God, known by you, the people of God. Verse 11, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. God has an eternal purpose. I don't believe for one second that once we get on the other side, once we're with the Lord and his kingdom, that we'll be just sitting around not doing much. God has an eternal purpose. I don't know what it is, but it's going to be exciting. And we're going to be busy. I can guarantee you that. Now, it'll be enjoyable at the same time, but if you just picture yourself just sitting around eating chocolate and playing a harp, I just don't think that's not what heaven's going to be. So many people have their idea of what heaven is. Yeah. What did the guy tell you this week, this evening? What did he say to you?
He said, yeah, heaven's, he's got a boat. God's got a boat up there. I've got to deal with God. He's got a boat up there for me, and I'm going to go fishing in heaven.
He's going to go boating and fishing in heaven. That's what he said to you this evening. Of course, a lost man, and he doesn't get it.
No.
But a lot of people have their idea. Well, I'm going to have my Harley up there, and I'm going to be riding around the golden streets or something like that. But God has plans for us. He has an eternal purpose. It's his purpose. It's not my purpose.
No.
See, that's where all these false religions are so wrong, right? They've got their idea of what heaven will be. Yeah. You know, with the Muslims, it's some guy having 70 virgins or something, right? Or the Mormons, being gods and populating their own planet, having multiple wives and having their own planet. They just populate. Yeah. That's not in the Bible. That's your purpose. Yeah. That's not God's purpose.
That's right.
It's his eternal purpose. Which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Verse 12, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him. Praise God for that boldness he gives us and that confidence. Don't cast away your confidence with heaven, which hath great recompense of reward, Hebrews says. Verse 13, wherefore I desire that ye faint not in my tribulations for you, which is your glory. We see how God was using Apostle Paul. We see how God was empowering him, how God was giving him confidence, giving him boldness. It was God in him. Paul's not lifting up himself here. He's lifting up Christ in him. May people see Christ in us and glory in that. And glory how God is using you to reach those around you for Christ, to be an encouragement, to be a blessing. Paul was a great blessing. Verse 14, for this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. A whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, and that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Verse 20 talks about how he's able. We serve a God who's very able. Number one, he's able to save us. Hebrews 7:25, he's able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God. That's anybody. That's everybody. That means there's hope for your family. Now, I don't know, preacher. Oh, yes. There's hope for them. There's hope for your neighbors, those you work with. Oh, pastor, you haven't met this one. There's hope for them. Listen, my dad was mean. My wife's dad was mean. I say was mean. They're still a little mean. they're just saved mean men now. They're not as mean as they used to be. But they were nasty. They just had no regard for God at all. None of my family before my dad got saved went to church. No one. I don't come from a religious family before my parents. Care less about God, the Bible, church stuff. Really, I should still be a heathen. Really. I come from a long line of heathens and pagans. I do. But God was merciful. And saved my dad, even though he was wicked. I had no regard for God. He used to cuss and swear at the guy he used to witness to about the Lord. Guy would tell him about the Lord Jesus, how, Mike, you need to get saved. Cuss and swear and give him a hard time. The man just kept telling about Jesus, kept loving him, kept praying for him. Used to go back behind his house. He had an altar down the woods there where he used to pray for my dad to get saved. My dad, I believe with all my heart, was literally praying into the kingdom of God by that dear old gentleman. His name was James Craig, Jimmy Craig. Never have a chance, I go by his grave. I leave some flowers in his grave. It's because of Jimmy Craig that I'm saved today. Yeah. He didn't give up on my dad. God in him, Jesus in him, did not give up on my dad. Right. See, it's not us, it's Jesus in us that causes us to reach people. If you're trying to reach him, yeah, you'll fail. You'll fail miserably. But when Christ is living through you and in you, then you can penetrate. Then you can get through it. They need to see Jesus. They need to see his love, experience his love coming out of it. So that's what my dad experienced, and he couldn't get away from it. It drove him nuts. Who is this guy that I hate so much, but he loves me so much? How can that be? I told him to get out of my life. Leave me alone, you idiot, you Bible thumper, you nut, you religious fanatic. Get away from me. Of course, my dad used a lot of other words that I wouldn't use. But he just kept loving me. And finally, God used to break his stony heart. That's what God can do. Saved his soul, made him a preacher, someone that loves people, wants to help people, cares about the church, has love for everybody. Amazing, that's what my God, he who is able, Paul says. Now to him that is able, verse 20, he's able to save, he's able to keep that which I've committed. I've committed my heart, my all, like Miss Eva says, all the pieces I give him to all. Here I am, God, take all the puzzle pieces. And he keeps me.
Look at it, 2 Timothy 1:12. He keeps that which I've committed. He's the keeper of my soul. Number three, he's able to keep us from falling. Right? He's able to help us and give us strength to walk this life victoriously over sin, over our flesh, the world, the devil. He's able to make all grace abound towards us. Heard Brother Hardman in his testimony on Wednesday night talking about how he went through that cancer and the treatments and everything, and how God gave him grace through all of that. God's able to do the same for us. What a wonderful God. And then, number five, he's able to do exceeding abundantly, as Paul says here, above all that we can ask or think. You know, I can think of a lot of things. But the Bible says he's able to do even far above that. I can think about what God could do here in Cornwall, you know? How God could bless and save souls. I've got a burden for him to reach the Mohawk Nation. We went over there yesterday visiting a family. I've got things in my mind of what I think God could do here, you know, in time. But God says, Pastor Todd, I could do even more than that.
Right.
Yes. Yes! That's the kind of God we serve. Amen. I'm so glad that I serve such a God that wants to do exceeding and is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we even ask or think. Now notice this last phrase, if you didn't catch it before, according to, verse 20, the power that worketh in us. Isn't that good? So let's go back to our first verse again. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles. What does it mean to be a prisoner of Jesus Christ? Paul didn't say for Christ. He didn't say of Rome. He said of Jesus Christ. He meant what he said. So if Apostle Paul were here today, what would he tell us? Well, he did tell us. Let's look at this. Verse number 16, look at that one again. That he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. What's Paul getting at here in verse 16? I believe he's getting at dependence on God. A prisoner's dependent, right? They can't go to the grocery store, grab some food, dependent. May we be dependent on Christ more and more. Listen, if you've got it in your head that the longer you're saved, the more you're independent, you got it all wrong. See, this is different than physical growth. So much different. As you get older physically, well, you become naturally more independent. Right? You grow up, you finally leave home, you start your own life, have your own family. But not so spiritually. In fact, you become and should become more dependent on God.
That's right.
That's what God's trying to work in you. Make you more and more and more dependent on Him. Not more independent. Okay? If you're thinking that way, going that way, get that out of your head. It's the wrong way of thinking. Okay? I need God more each day. I need more communion. I need more time talking with Him. I need more prayer time. I need more studying His Word.
Yes.
I desire His Word more and more. The more I get into it, the more I study it. It's like, wow, this is so good. You know? It's like, you know, you just can't wait to pick up God's Word in the morning and see what something new He has for you. You know, it's awesome. I put in the Facebook page this past week, it's invigorating. God's Word is invigorating. It is. It's wonderful. It's awesome. And we should become more and more reliant on the Lord as we go along. Now, understand we grow at our own rates. We all grow differently, but we should be growing. You know, we start out, you know, like Peter talks about his newborn babes, desiring the sincere milk of the Word that you may grow thereby. But we should never stop growing. And we should never stop getting more and more reliant and dependent on God as we go along. It should never be a time that you feel like, I can handle this. I got it, God. I'm good. I'm okay. You know, I've arrived. I think I know most of the Bible. I know most of the Bible stories. I'm good. No. There'll never be a time we can handle sin.
Right.
Never. Or handle the devil. Or handle our flesh. Or this world and all its allurements. We need God more and more and more. I believe that's what Paul's getting at. That's part of being a prisoner of Jesus Christ. To be strengthened, verse 16, with might by His Spirit in the inner man. How much I need His strength. How much I need to depend on Him more and more each day. You know, sometimes I catch myself, I'm like, you haven't prayed yet. What is wrong with you? Mm-hmm. I get going, busy, and doing something, or something comes up, you know, phone rings, you get going with the day or something. But I catch myself, like, I forgot to pray. Right? So I'll try and get alone and pray, or you forgot to read your Bible, what are you doing? You know? Stop! You know? Take a break. Or the next break time, or whatever, you know? Grab your Bible, grab your New Testament or something. God, I need something today. Lord, help me. Train yourself to depend on God. Work at it. Don't just say, I'll pray tomorrow. I'll read the Bible tomorrow. Don't push it off, okay? Don't do that. You need the Lord. Because there could be some coldness set in there if you can put it off. You know what I mean? You need the Lord all the time, every day. You need to walk with Him, talk with Him. That's part of living by faith. That's how we get that empowerment. Notice it says, strengthened with might by His Spirit. This is not something you work up in yourself. Okay, I can do this. I'm going to have a good day. I know it's raining out, so I can do this. That's the way you live when you're lost. You psyched yourself up for the day, you know. I can do this, I can do this. No, we don't do that anymore.
Good.
We rely on the Lord. We strengthen with His might by His Spirit in the inner man. Now, let's stay dependent on the Lord. We might be independent Baptist, but we need to be dependent on the Lord. Okay?
Right.
Don't get those confused. Number 2, look at verse 17. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love. Not only is a prisoner dependent, but a prisoner is also secured, you might say confined. And we talked about that bondage earlier. It's a good kind of bondage, kind of like a good marriage. We're secure in Christ. God is working in each and every one of you to be more and more secure in Him, more and more stable.
Yeah.
Stable as a Christian. Not blown around here and there, and so that you know what you believe. You're firm on the foundation of Christ and His Word. You can give an answer for what you believe, what you know in your heart, what God has done. You're stable now. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love, secure in Christ, rooted in Him, grounded in Him, in His love. What a wonderful place to be, in His love. Established firmly in His love. Peter says, but the God of all grace, who hath called us unto His eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, and there is suffering along the way that we go through as a Christian. We go through trials, we go through temptations, we go through tribulations of life, all of us do. We each get our share, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
You've had your share, you're having your share.
Yeah.
I'll have mine. But after that you have suffered a while, what's God doing through all this?
Yeah.
He's making us perfect. He's establishing us. He's strengthening us. And he's settling us. Right? Perfect. I make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. God's working in each and every one of us to make us more and more stable as the people of God. If you look over there in verse 14 of chapter 4, we're kind of skipping ahead a little bit, but it says that we henceforth be no more like children. God wants you to grow up. I'm not going to feed you milk forever.
Right.
God wants you to grow some teeth and start eating some meat and stuff. Right? Things you have to chew. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro.
Well, I don't know. I heard this guy on YouTube. Now I don't know. I don't know what I believe in.
No, not tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. A lot of deceivers out there. A lot of people don't care about you. They just want to make a name for themselves. And so they come up with these strange ideas contrary to God's word. They confuse people. Listen, if you're saved, you have the Holy Spirit of God within you. You can understand the Bible. You can know exactly what God means. Right? There's only one Holy Spirit. That means we should all come to the same conclusion. You don't have a different Holy Spirit than I do. We've both got the same. Same third person of the Godhead. God reveals to his children, if they truly want to know the truth, if they just clear their minds of everything maybe they've heard or whatever, this one's opinion, that one's opinion, just say, God, it's just me and you. Lord, what does this mean?
Right.
And if you'll just be quiet, shut up, stop thinking about everything else, let God just show you what he means. He will do so. God is working in us to stabilize us, to secure us in himself. Why? Because we are the prisoners of Jesus Christ. It's actually a very, very safe place to be. Grounded, rooted and grounded in his love. And then lastly, verse 19, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, and that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. Lastly, God means to reform us and transform us, may I say, over time, to make us into the image of his own Son. God's intention is to make you like his Son. Don't you get it? God doesn't want you to be you.
That offends me.
Yeah.
It's true.
But I'm me, and I've got my rights, and I've my opinions, and how I feel.
Listen, you are a prisoner of Jesus Christ.
Right.
He's here to reform you into his image.
Yes.
To make you a Jesus, like Jesus, a true Christian, someone who's truly Christ-like. Acts and responds and talks and thinks like Christ. So stop thinking so much about yourself. We think too highly of ourselves sometimes, don't we? He's transforming us as we yield to him more and more. Paul says in Romans, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. That's an ongoing process of sanctification. God's working in our lives. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. This is how to find the will of God. Allow him to make you like Jesus. And stop holding on to your rights.
Yeah.
Well, I know I'm saved, but I got my rights.
Yeah.
No, you don't. No, you don't. You never had your rights. You were the child of the devil before.
Yeah.
Now you're a child of God.
Yeah.
Everybody answers to somebody, don't they?
Yeah.
Everybody's got a master.
Yeah.
It's just you thought when you were lost before you were serving yourself, but I mean, you were in a way, but you're really serving the devil, aren't you? You're doing what he wanted you to do with your life, which is mess up your life.
Yeah.
That's what he wanted you to do, and you were doing it.
Yeah.
So really, you were serving him, weren't you? Well, now that you're saying, won't you serve God? He's a good master.
Yes.
Now, what I'm going to share with you now is somewhat controversial. I grew up in the Southeast U.S. And I remember as a kid, we used to go on little tours. You know, they take you out for a field day, you know, go on a field trip. Put you in the bus and all the kids would go out. We go to these plantations where they used to have slaves years ago, black slaves. We see the little houses they used to live in, you know, go around and see the fields where they used to work in. I remember going to this one house where there was a blood stain they showed us on the floor. That was kind of freaky. Somebody had been murdered there or something. But you know what? You hear stories about the slaves being mistreated, and certainly that was the case. Many of them, I'm sure, were beaten and treated cruelly, treated like animals. But I think you also find in history that, in some cases, some plantation owners treated the slaves like they're his own children, treated them well, made them nice little cabins, very comfortable, did not overwork them, took care of them, fed them good meals, right? Looked after them. Is not God that way to us? He's a good master. But we're safe with him. He loves us. He cares for us. He takes care of us. Now the devil, he's the mean master. He abuses his children.
That's right.
Let's not get in our minds that way of thinking any longer. Now we're the servants of Christ. And we've never been our own. We never will be our own. Okay? Now you're God's. You're his. Bought with a price. If you're truly saved, that doesn't bother you. Now, if you're not truly saved, maybe that bothers you. What do you mean, I'll never be my own?
Yeah.
I'm glad in Christ. What security is in that? Oh, to know that he'll always take care of me. He loves me. He's adopted me into his family. It's almost like on one of those big plantations, you usually have a big house, you know, the big pillars in front, you know, and it's like God, he's like the good slave owner that has adopted me to his family. Now I live in the big house.
Yeah.
With the owner, with the master. Yes, that's right. Oh, what a good God we serve. And he's working in us as we yield to being this prisoner of Jesus Christ. All these things. How to become more reliant on him. Each and every day, and throughout the day, to make us not only rely on him, but stabilizing us in him. God wants you to be assured of what you believe, and be strong in his grace, and so you can grow and help others along the way that are struggling, right? Maybe those that have failed, you say, I fell before, but I got right with God. You can get right with God. Let me help you up, brother. Let me help you up, sister. Stabilizing you so you can do that. Listen, if you're having all kinds of spiritual problems yourself, how are you going to help others?
Right.
You don't have a close walk with God. You don't have the power in your life. How can you help others? You can't do it. Spiritually, you can't help them.
Yeah.
Unless you're walking with God. Unless you have his power, his might working in you, stabilizing you. And then that transformation of him, making you more like Christ. Not like me. Not what I want to be. Not my dreams. Throw them out the window. What does God want me to be? What's God's will for me? I can honestly say I'm in the will of God here in Cornwall. Being with you here today, I'm honored to be with you. We love you, my family. We love you. We care about you. And we are in the perfect will of God. It's such a blessing to know that. That I'm exactly where God wants me to be, serving the Lord. Being a servant to you, God's people. What an honor. What a blessing. That's awesome. I wouldn't trade place with anybody. Pastor, what if somebody gave you $100 million? Would you quit church? Would you quit being a pastor? How about 100 billion? How about 100 trillion? No! I'm doing exactly what God Almighty wants me to do with my life at this very moment. No amount of money or whatever will change my mind. I'm not doing it for money. If I was doing it for money, I would have kept my job. I had, I would have kept my career. I gave that up years ago. How long have we been in the ministry now? Since 2008. I gave my job end of March 2008. I said goodbye to my career. My bosses, my managers thought I was nuts. Throwing it all away. Just take a leave of absence. You can come back if it doesn't work out. No. God wants me to go full time in ministry. Do I look like I'm starving? God's been good. God's took care of us. Now, we don't have a lot. A few bucks in the bank. Cars are paid for, thank God. We rent a place. We've never owned a house. I don't know if we ever will. I may never own a house. I may never own a piece of property on this earth. That doesn't bother me. I just want to do God's will. That's all that matters to me. I don't care where I live, what I'm doing. The missionary lady that's going to be speaking September the 8th and 9th, she had a bit of a battle going on in her mind before, I don't know, before she got married or what it was, but before she met her husband, about going to Africa to be a missionary. And she said, God will go anywhere in the world except Africa. I'll be a missionary anywhere, God, just not Africa. Guess where God called her, her and her husband. Now, I'm not saying God's going to call you to Africa, but we need to be willing to go wherever God wants and do whatever He wants us to do. And you know, if you'll do that, you'll be the happiest.
Yes.
You'll be the most at peace because it's God's will. That's right. So let's allow God to continue working in us as the prisoners of Jesus Christ. I'm proud to be a prisoner of my Lord and Savior. He's a good master. He's a good Lord.